Hey, guess who we have on the phone?
Ooh.
We have the number one Pixie 3.
Yeah.
Debra Swisher Horn. How are you, Debra?
Oh, I'm so great. We're doing great, and I hear that you're doing great too, Ned. It's so good to talk to you and Kristen. I'm serious.
Oh, my gosh. This is so much fun. You know, you rank up as one of the top. You and Denise Ferry rank at the top of our interview list.
Yeah.
Oh, well, Denise is a doll, so I'm happy to be in her company, I'm telling you that.
Oh, and Diane Renee. We had her on last night.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what a doll, right?
Yes. What a story she gave us about, you know, when she came out with Navy Blue. Now, I don't know. I'm going to ask you the same kind of question I asked Diane last night. And the fact that was a teenager and having a big hit on radio.
I know.
How was it when you were walking around the school grounds?
You know, that's one of my favorite things to talk about, too, because the Pixies 3 in high school, I was in 10th grade, I guess, when Birthday Party was out.
Wow.
And we started going, well, we started with our shows, all around the world shows in our breezeway when we were 7 to 9. I'm talking about Kay McCool now. Kay and I started the Pixies 3. And we both lived on Penn Street, and we were doing a duo. And the very first contest we did, we sang, and it was 1957. It was a popular that year, Bye Bye Love by the Everly Brothers.
Right.
And so Kay and I did that at the Y talent show and won first place. I think it was $25, and that did it. Probably the money more than anything, just kidding. no, but we had that, and we played the guitar with the ukuleles, and anyway, finally, then we won Ted Mack Amateur Hour twice, so that was our first train ride to New York City from Hanover, and that was neat, and then we're coming up to where we went to Philadelphia. My mom took us there. She was our manager. We'd have got Midge, then now there was three of us, the Pixies 3, and we interviewed at a nightclub in Philly, and we heard that the different producers would hang out there. So we were, of course, underage. We were slid under in the back way and slid out the back way because there was drinking involved, and you know, we couldn't be in there. So we did our little song and didn't hear from the Madeira and White was in there at the time, but didn't hear back. We heard from them, and then we didn't sign. And then we drove to Philadelphia, and my mother drove us down there, and we went into Madeira and White's office and said, okay, we didn't get a signature yet, so we went in there and sang the Pop, 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 Pop by the Sherrys.
Mm-hmm.
That was one of their groups. Pop, 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 Pop. And we sang that for them. We said, well, that'll get them. Well, the first thing they said was, oh, you missed the second verse and the second word and the second, third area there. And, oh, well, we sang the whole word. But eventually we got a contract with Mercury Records, and walking down the halls in Hanover, Pennsylvania was wonderful. I mean, we never acted weird because we weren't weird. We were just one of the girls that had to, you know, we had a record on the radio. And everything, what I'm saying is everything progressed so naturally for us. We never had like, oh, except, of course, that first time we heard it on the radio, you know, how everybody feels about that.
Wow.
But it was, as long as we maintained to be average in high school, they would let us out early on Thursday, and then we could go do sock hops and different shows Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Amazing.
We maintained that. Or Thursday night, you know. Then we'd sometimes have to write a paper on, you know, what we did. I guess that was good for us. But we were normal kids. We looked forward to the time we could stay home from going to the sock pop sometimes to go to our high school football games, you know, just to be normal. We all had boyfriends. I mean, it was just like that. So I'm sorry there wasn't any big hoity-toity, but we were just normal kids, and the people treated us that way.
What
we treated them that way.
What Diane was saying too last night is the fact that when she walked through the schools or through the halls at school, she the alien aided her. And
oh, they did not us. Oh, that's awful.
Yeah, and she was really, and that really, truly, by her voice still, today, yesterday, she was still really upset about that. And
well, you can tell we were just great about it. I mean, I was still voted queen, and when they had to vote for the different queen things, and probably because they knew my name more than anybody else, so they could write it down quicker.
Probably.
It wasn't anything to do with me, they just knew the name, but... No, and we moved around. We didn't act, in fact, we act up, less than uppity. Maybe we act under, you know what I mean?
Right.
We act under normal. Just
kinda
around and slouching and stuff like that.
My question here is, this is a question I don't normally ask, but
okay.
How did the name Pixies 3 come up?
Well, we were first the Katie, Kay and I were the Katie Mids. No, we were the Katie Dids, yeah.
The Katie Kids.
And we became the Katie Mids, Kay, Debbie, and Midge, Katie Mids. And then we all had pixie haircuts, that's how it came about. And we were just called the Pixies. By the time Madeira and White got us on Mercury Records, though, there was a conflict. There was a group in Baltimore, they were called the Pixies. And rather than worry about, litigation and stuff down the road in case something did happen with the record, they said, we'll just go with the Pixies 3. So that's what we did. So it was Pixie Haircuts that got us the Pixies.
Wow. That is cool.
That is.
I had a laugh the way you said, I clean up quite well.
You do. Oh, my gosh. And those pictures and your prom pictures. Oh, I want to go to the prom with you, man.
Oh, you really? Okay. Well, next time we have next year a prom, make sure you take a ride up here to Allentown.
Get in on it.
you always see me in my barn clothes.
I know. Well, you're always kissing. You're kissing animals' lips. I like that about you.
Oh, my donkeys. Yes, they're spiritual little creatures, they are.
Mm-hmm.
And the Clydesdales, yeah. Well, it is what it is, but I enjoy them. That is kind of like my out away from here. And you just have that. The songs you sang, for instance, this one, 442 Glenwood Avenue. What? There is such an address.
There is. There's addresses. Glenwood Avenue, they're all over. We found out later. And one time we did a party in Boston. I guess it was fraternity. A fraternity's address was 442 Glenwood Avenue. And they went nuts over that. And of course, we didn't know where they were going. Unless we thought it was us. No, it was a fraternity. But, yeah, that was just a random number they chose. Madeira and White wrote that. And so, wait a minute, I got to close my car door. I'm in Branson, Missouri, sitting in front of Frank Sinatra Theater. People are getting out. Okay.
So people are listening to you being interviewed on your phone.
Yes, they're going out towards the theater.
Oh, my
and
gosh.
We're in Branson in our motor home, and you talk about animals. We have, you'll relate to this, we have a 16-year-old poodle. We had her since she was like 6 weeks.
Aww.
And so we're basically 24-hour dog nurses right now. She still walks pretty well and hears okay and sees some things. But boy, have you ever had an animal age like that and the end of years?
It's tough. It really is. It'll be July 2 years that we lost our Clydesdale stallion. And, and the day before he passed was really funny. Not really funny, but he was fine. And then the next day he was sick. And 3-4 hours later, he passed away.
How lucky. I hope Lulu gets like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like this week, it was really hot, so I was walking around in our park. And she laid on the grass, and her feet went down, and she wouldn't get up. She got up a little bit and kind of like pulled herself from her front legs. Oh, I picked her up and took her in the motorhome. Every time I'm all there by myself, I come in and tell Bob what's happening. And what does she do? She stands up and she flips around like she's 2 months old. I mean, it's in and out like that.
They are. Animals are like that, and they really are. On some of your other songs, like Cold Cold Winter, was that specifically done for more or less a Christmas type song, or just a winter song?
I think it was just a winter song. It wasn't a Christmas. I wish it would have been a Christmas song, because you know how Christmas songs come back every year.
Right.
And they become very, very famous that way, just because they're timely. But no, that was just a winter song, and that's the one they flipped over. And it didn't really sound so much like a Pixie song, though, I didn't think.
No, it didn't. Come to think of it, it didn't. Then you had House Party in 1964.
Oh, well, that was on the album Party with the Pixies 3, and that whole album was kind of done live in the studio with the party theme.
Right.
You know, and that was on that. But that was a real fun album to do, because there again, you know, we're in high school. We had the tracks, and we would rehearse that in our living room there on 306 Baltimore Street, where I lived. And we would rehearse that every day, every day, every day. And by the time we got to the studio, we had from our Wall and Sack. You remember the days of the Wall and Sack?
Right, right.
They were the top of the line reel.
Yes, and I have one.
Does that work?
Yes, it does. Believe it or not, I do have a Wallensack, and I have a TIAC, and I have actually about three or four that I confiscated from radio stations that I work from.
Oh, my God. You know, I've given Kay. I gave her. She is such a, you know, she keeps the memorabilia because she has children, and she has somebody to pass it down to. You know, my dogs really don't care about getting Wallensack.
But I do.
But I gave all those reel-to-reels to her, and she tried to, she had a wall or some kind of reel-to-reel at one time. I don't know what happened to that, but yeah, anyway, we went to the studio, and we had, it's kind of like today with tracks. We knew our parts when we got there, and we did that whole album in about two or three weekends in New York.
Wow.
So we went up there and got that done. Now, what do? They take, a year for one song?
Yeah.
Oh,
6 months?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
You know, Kristen, about in your doo-wop group, how long it takes to really perfect a doo-wop song, right?
Yes, it does.
Over and over, and then with, you know, it always takes it live to get it toned in just right, I think.
Mm-hmm. How far, when you lived in Hanover, how far did all three of you live apart from each other?
At the first it was like one minute up the hill, and then I moved over town, probably 10 minutes tops. We were together all the time.
Wow.
That's neat.
That is cool.
Yeah.
That is,
I've known Kay McCool since, well, I was in first grade, and then Bonnie I've known since church, probably second grade. And Midge I've known that long too, and you know, we all still keep in touch and love each other. We had our separate ways. When Midge quit, we got Bonnie.
Mm-hmm.
Then I quit, Midge came back. And so everybody got to be a Pixies 3 in their older years. Isn't that just beautiful?
It is.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's, you hear all these awful rumblings in groups, and we just don't want that. We just won't let it happen.
You guys have this togetherness about you, when so many other groups, you know, they egos get in the way, and I do believe that.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's in every situation, husband, wife, girlfriend, boyfriend, girlfriend, girlfriend, and groups, but you just have to calm it down, come back to your spiritual, you know, you have God in your life, and that's the main thing, and so you have to come back to your roots, and with the Pixies 3, you know, we've watched each other's moms died. I mean, we've known each other's and their families pass away, and the good times and the bad times.
I believe that, yes. And that can be tough.
And that sticks you together, too, better.
I think it does as well, you know. And so many people have asked me since we were put, since I was going to have you on the show, you know, that are they still, do they still perform together? Do they still get together as just the Pixies three sit down and have supper? And I know you all live pretty much far apart from each other.
Yeah, we can't do supper. We're going to Bonnie's house. Oh, what happened recently? We got Midge and we did a CD with Midge. It's called Timeless, and you can get it on the Pixies 3 website. It's a real cool CD. I'll have to send you one. Give me your address and I'll send you one. Or do you already have one?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I will private message you my address.
Okay, I'll get you one as soon as I get back from Branson. And with Midge, so I think that was 2013, we said, well, let's just do a CD of all the stuff that we like. It doesn't have to be old or new. We're not going to please. We're not trying to sell a million copies. Just get together and do some really cool things that we'd like. So we have everything on there from, I asked Midge to do Amazing Grace because we did that when we were little. So I had to have that one religious song in there that we did. Kay made the arrangements, and she did the Amazing Grace Celtic style, you know, Celtic style instruments.
Bagpipes.
And bagpipes. And so we have everything there from Boys from New York City to How About Us. I mean, all from, and then to, Did You Say I've Got a Love Tutor? Teach Me Tonight. You know, everything from big band to oldies to newies to religious. So it's just a conglomeration of songs that we didn't intend to sell. We didn't care if we sold one copy. We did it just to be having fun. Now, I think that's the way people ought to do things, don't you? Do something that comes from the heart.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And then it'll show.
It does. It really does. Are you all planning on getting together again?
Yeah. So I'm getting to that. I want to get off track. So the CDs, that was Midge. Midge had a vocal event, which Kristen, you can feel terrible. She has vocal dysfunction, and she's tried to get shots and treatments, and she can't even sing in her choir now over 30 minutes when she just, her voice stops.
Wow.
So she had to give us the news last year, girls, I can't do over 15 minutes. Well, you can't, got to rehearse more than 15 minutes, let alone a show. So
yeah.
Anyway, thank God Bonnie was free. And we got Bonnie back, and we're going to do Sunfest in Ocean City, Maryland in September. And that's a big deal because we did that in the old days, and we just had a ball down there on the beach.
Maybe we'll have to come down.
Yeah.
See
that's
that.
What, we're going to be there Thursday. I think it's September 20th, the afternoon show. Anyway, we're getting together at Bonnie's house, and she lives in Florida. And we're going to put this show together in August. So that's the next time I get to see him.
Wow.
I'm looking forward to that. I still do a lot. I do stuff on my own. We go south for the winter time, and, you know, in Florida, they call them snowbirds. But in Texas, if you go to South Texas, you're a winter Texan.
Oh, okay.
So we're winter Texans. So I do shows down there with my tracks. I still do. My band's called Debbie and the Invisibles.
I like that.
I always say, they're there, but you just cannot see them.
That's a good one.
That's very innovative on your part. I like that.
I always try to make my shows dance shows because, you know, all of our music is dance. Mm-hmm. And but have people stand there and stare at you when you know darn well they want to dance.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of insist on dancing at all my shows.
I don't blame you. I do have a question, though, that somebody asked me on a private message. And they said, would you ask Debbie a question? And I said, yeah. Would you ask her what her fountain of youth is?
Well, send that person a free ticket to Nassau.
Oh, my.
I don't know. It's called the blurry camera, maybe. That could be it.
Oh, I don't think the blurry camera. No, no.
But
no.
As far as weight goes, I watch my weight. I work out. I'm not a fanatical about it. Like just today, I had French fries and grilled cheese. But, you know, got to live. But then I'll fall off the wagon and eat a bunch, and then I'll pull back, and then I'm good. So yeah.
I eat a bunch of prime rib and then I pull back and then eat a couple hot dogs.
I see some of the stuff you eat.
Oh, you do. You really do follow me.
I'm telling you, that prime rib, now I could have one third of that at medium rare, thank you.
Oh, I love mine rare. I mean, I love it so rare, Debbie, that my veterinarian could give it a shot and up on its feet in about 10 minutes.
Give it a name.
When you first started the group, the Pixies 3, how were your parents, I mean, all three of you, how were the parents? Were they really behind you? Was there any saying that, well, maybe you shouldn't? And were they worried about fame or anything like that?
My mother was behind us 1,000% to start off with, because she's the one that saw the interest that we had. And she said, I never would have pushed you girls if I didn't see the love that you had, because there's nothing worse to push somebody out there. And then, of course, Kay was her, Eleanor McCool was Kay's mom. She, too, was behind us. And there, after we got the group going, the Ballingers, Midge's people, they would take us to different shows, too. So all the parents were on board. And I remember especially a thing in my head that I could just see the three girls down there in Atlantic City. In the summertime, there was a place called Atlantic City on the Steel Pier.
Right, right.
The one that went jutted out and the ocean is gone. Well, at the very end of the Steel Pier, there was a thing called Tony Grant Stars of Tomorrow.
Yes.
But did you happen to ever be there?
I was never there, but I did hear about that. Yes, yes.
Well, we were on Tony Grant Stars of Tomorrow, and we weren't the richest people in the world. We weren't poor, we weren't rich. We were like middle-of-the-road people. And, you know, our dad worked for the Hanover Shoe Company, and so did Midge's. And then, Kay's parents was in education. So we would go down there, and we would rent one of those half houses and things. And I have pictures of all three mothers, you know, in their underwear, and we're trying all getting ready for the show, and we all have our hair in these great big rollers, and getting ready for our little dresses. That a lot of times our parents would make our little dresses and make the buttons match the skirts, you know, those kind of wide skirts, and make the buttons match the skirts, and then cummerbunds, and that would be our outfit. But we were on the Tony Grant Stars of Tomorrow, Atlantic City, and all three mothers were there, and we would see Ricky Nelson at the end of the Steel Pier when he was there. And such great memories, you know. We kept in touch with a lot of the people there, too. There was one little group there, Joe and Hutch. Of course, I had to fall in love with Hutch, and Kay had to fall in love with Joe. And, you know, how love is. I think we even kissed. Yeah, I'm pretty sure we did.
Oh.
But, yeah, we went that far.
Say three Our Fathers and three Hail Marys.
I know. Here we go again. But anyway, became good friends with their parents, too. And so we would go to see them in New Jersey and just things like that. So, yeah, but the Steel Pier holds great memories. Later on, what really was... Okay, we were in Tony Grant Stars of Tomorrow. Later on, when I joined the Angels and became the lead singer of the Angels, we were the headliners on the Steel Pier, and I'll never forget my dad in the audience just later. He was crying his little head out because I was standing there singing Toe with that big orchestra on the main stage at Steel Pier, thinking about the time we were back in the Tony Grant. You know what I mean?
Right. Now, you were the lead voice on Till by the Angels then.
No. I joined the Angels after the Pixies 3.
Oh, okay.
And see, my boyfriend's back was out in, 63?
63.
Our stuff was out 63, and our stuff was out 64. We did shows with them, with the Angels. They're much older.
Yeah, that was Peggy Santiglia that sang.
Yeah, Peggy Santiglia is the lead.
Right.
And so I took her place and traveled with them for a couple of years in New York stuff.
Wow.
So, that was neat. We did a lot of good stuff with them, and I got to live in New York City and on my own.
How did you like that? How did you like the city?
I loved it, and it wasn't as scary as you might think, because everything that I needed was in one city block. I wouldn't, I mean, I could walk to everything unless I had to go to a show. Then we would rent a car.
Out of all the Pixie 3 songs, out of all of them that you guys put together and sang, which one is your favorite?
I loved one that wasn't a hit. It's on the album, After the Party. I think that's still fun to sing, and we do it at every show at the end.
After the Party.
After the Party, we'll take the long way home. After the Party, we'll finally be alone. We had a lot of fun. We really had a ball. Dancing together, the kiss in the hall. It's
wow.
So nice.
And that's your favorite.
Yeah, as far as the hits go, of course, my favorite hit is Birthday Party.
Yes.
The most places.
That was 1963 when that came out.
Yeah, yeah.
I also, one of my favorite Pixie 3 songs is the one that I think was stolen from you, or you guys were just a little too late.
Oh, yeah. Make me your baby.
Make me your baby. I get more, seriously, and I'm not kidding because I'm talking to you, I get more requests for the Pixies 3 version than Barbara Lewis.
I did not know that. We were sick when that happened. You really do?
Yes, believe it or not, because, and I do believe this, and I believe with a lot of other people that have covered other songs and that, is because Barbara Lewis is always, you know, bam, bam, bam on the radio. But the Pixies 3 version, I think it's more harmony, more, it just more love to that song when you guys did it.
Oh my gosh, that was an... Well, if I could include that song, that would be, yeah, I love singing that song, and I just love the song, too. Well, thank you. I didn't even know people knew how to get that song. Where did you get it?
I stole it, like the Wall and Sock tape players, too.
Well, I think that's a wonderful steal.
Well, it is a wonderful steal because people do love it. Randy Cefuto of Randy and the Rainbows, he did a song called Black and Gold, and he doesn't even have a 45 of it. I do, and there are only two copies ever made.
Oh, my. Can you imagine that?
And he says to me, Ned, where the heck did you get that thing at? I says, you never know where I get stuff. They said, what kind of magic do you have? I says, I have a magic wand, and I can twist some arms.
That is fabulous. Hey, I'm going to have to twist some arms here. This show starts in 1 minute. Let's call back again sometime, can we?
Sure can. You sure can. And
I've enjoyed this half hour with you. Oh, my gosh, it flew by.
It did. It really did. Well, thank you very much, Debbie. We're going to play a couple of your songs
thank
and Make
you.
Me Your Baby and all this and that. And hopefully in September, we'll see you. We'll see you in September down in Ocean City. I'm not going to sing. I'm not going
to
sing.
I will be so happy.
I would love to show up. We're going to have to make that a vacation.
Yeah, put that on your thing.
I will. All right, Debbie. Thank you kindly.
Take care.
Go enjoy your show.
Okay. Love you guys. And
love you
thank
too.
You anytime. Let's talk.
All righty, Deb. Thank you. Love you too, hon.
Bye, Kristen.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye, honey.
Bye-bye.